Hi, it's Toinon, CEO of Waalaxy, and today I'm going to tell you about all the mistakes I made when I launched my company, and there are a lot of them. I started out as an entrepreneur at the age of 21, in the middle of my engineering studies. We often talk about Waalaxy because today it's our main product, but today I'm going to talk about the Waapi story, because Waapi is actually our company, the name of our current business. And at that age, you make all the mistakes you can. It's really a checklist of all the mistakes you need to make to understand how to start a business, how to grow your company. I think I've ticked them all off. So the idea is to tell you a little about what we went through with Waapi. Waapi was really a student's idea, the typical idea of someone who wants to start a business. In fact, we wanted to create an application for campsites. We were two partners, we'd worked in campsites, and we thought camping, big upscale in camping, and therefore need to digitize. We wanted to create an application that would digitalize the experience of before, during, and after your stay. The idea was that when a customer arrives, he can check in online, take photos of the state of his accommodation, ask a question at reception, find out about tourist activities in the area, book an aqua gym lesson, chat with reception, book a kayak activity next door, with even a social networking dimension. So the aim was for me to be able to offer my game of beach volleyball, that sort of thing. And it was really a whole range of functionalities that we wanted to develop. I think one of our first big mistakes was to try to develop lots of features, saying to ourselves, we're going to solve lots of problems. And we ended up with a product that did everything, but everything badly. We weren't at all focused on solving a key problem for the campsite manager. We were thinking, there's such and such a thing, there's such and such a feature. As a result, when we were confronted with our potential customers, they would say, oh, well, I'm interested in your social network part, but you see, it's missing such and such feature, it's missing such and such thing. None of our functionalities were really complete. And that's really the error of the shiny object when you start. It's to say to yourself, I'm going to make all the possible features to serve all the use cases, and in fact, when you serve everyone, you serve no one. And that was really the case for us. Our potential customers didn't see themselves in the product at all, because everyone had different needs, and we never served one need very well. When you start, the competition doesn't exist. Because of the size of our markets, the concept of competition shouldn't be something you think about when you start up your own business. It's a legacy of the big groups, and one that incubators will often bring to entrepreneurs by saying, what's your positioning in the market? In fact, who cares? In any market, there are always people who aren't being served, people who are early adopters and who want to try out the new thing, people who don't even know what's on offer when you launch. And so, at launch, who cares about the competition? Except that, at the time, we were really obsessed with the competition, and so all we did was look at the competitors and see what they were doing. And as soon as they came out with a feature, we had to copy them, we had to add it, as if we weren't going to succeed in our business if we didn't have all the features of all the competitors. And in the end, we completely lost sight of what we wanted to do in the first place. By trying to copy others, we lost the initial meaning of the product and lost our way. We spent almost a year developing lots of features in our bedroom, literally in our bedroom, coding all day long, saying, we're going to add this brick, etc. But when time came to face up to our prospects, they said to us, wait a minute, I'm in an off-grid area, so your application has to work offline. Does it work offline? No, we hadn't thought about that at all. I needed to be synchronized with my tools. Have you thought about synchronizing with the tools? We hadn't thought about that at all. And a whole host of other issues that we hadn't really thought about because we never talked to them. We ended up with a product full of features that didn't correspond at all to what our customers wanted because we hadn't talked to them. So really, the mistake to avoid is not talking to your customers and thinking, you know, today, if I had to relaunch a business, the first thing I'd do is go and talk to them, talk to the people I think I can sell my product to, and try to understand before trying to sell. Try to understand the need and try to understand the pains. Why aren't they solved today? What's holding them back? What's on the market and why isn't it solving my customers' pains? And really go digging like a therapist with your prospect to really understand what's underlying it all. And that's what's going to give you the insights you need to make a product that meets a need. And it's by making a product that meets a need that you'll make a product that sells. My personal conviction is that the French startup ecosystem is a bit gangrenous. We've got big groups and a government that are saying, we're going to make a startup nation, so we're going to put lots of money into launching startups. And so we've got big groups that want to restore their image by setting up incubators, running competitions, doing all kinds of things that make them say, oh, we're in the innovation business, we're helping startups. And on the other side, a government that obviously also wants to help startups. And we end up with entrepreneurs who are in a form of assistanat, i.e. they are accompanied from everywhere. They have the impression that there are people who will do things for them. But at the end of the day, it's only you as an entrepreneur who's driving your business forward. And most of the people around you are in it to maximize their own personal interests. And the truth is, if startups bite the dust, nobody cares. And so they're not really going to help you launch your business. They're going to smooth talk, chase their tail, and show that they're in the startup ecosystem. And that's a real problem because the entrepreneur is going to be completely defocused and he's going to chase his own tail with these things. It obviously flatters the ego. I've got a press article. Yeah, I'm incubated, I won a competition, and in the end, it doesn't advance your business at all. You haven't advanced your product, you haven't found any customers. any incubator, major corporation, bank, etc., is going to ask you to draw up a business plan with 5-year financial forecasts. So when you launch your company, predicting what you're going to do next week isn't far from clairvoyance. But 5 years out, it's just writing random stuff for the paper, which is pointless. I remember spending 3 weeks locked up in my room writing a business plan, making financial forecasts, and during that time the business wasn't making any headway. Your human resources consist of 2 or 3 partners at the outset. So if you have a whole human resource devoted to writing business plans and making financial forecasts, it's just a waste of time. So if you ever really need these documents, you delegate it to an accountant. Find a freelancer on the internet who can write you a bullshit forecast. What really counts is being focused on the business. You've got startup competitions all over the place, and they're great fun and flatter the ego. We won a lot of competitions with our camping project because we were really good at pitching our project, so we were able to convince people who didn't need our product that our product was useful, and that's really easy. As soon as you have people who don't know your market, you try to convince them that you know your market, you explain the problem you're solving, your solution, and all of a sudden, it's just a rhetorical exercise and a marketing exercise, and it doesn't add anything to the business. And it's going to take a lot of energy to fill out these competition forms, often for ridiculous winnings that won't really advance the business. The government provides a great deal of funding for startups, which is a very positive thing in many respects, but it's going to take startups away from the I absolutely have to sell approach. When we launched Waapi, we had raised almost $100,000 in public money or zero interest loans from schemes and so on. And with this money, we were able to make a living, and so we could afford not to make any income. And the moment when we started to change activity to really make sales was when we reached the end of our funds. We'd run out of public money, so we had to make some sales to survive, otherwise we knew we'd really be going home. And that's really when we kicked ourselves up the ass and started doing business and selling and trying to make a living from our product. So public money is a great thing to help a lot of companies get started to get the first resources. But it often takes us away from the urgency of making sales. It's the same with unemployment. We often find that businesses launched by people who are unemployed start to explode after 2 years. When people say to themselves, I'm coming to the end of my unemployment benefit, I've got 2 or 3 months left, I've really got to get a move on. Because otherwise, if I can't pay myself a salary, then it's back home, end of game. In the ecosystem, we've got the incubators, we've got the big groups, we've got the BPI, we've got the state, who are going to try to take time away from entrepreneurs to maximize their personal interests. There are also journalists. Journalists love innovative, slightly original subjects. For some businesses, it's a real opportunity to get communication. But what you need to know is that most general media will bring you conversions that are ridiculous, especially in B2B. It's a non-subject. It's very hard for an entrepreneur just starting out. And clearly that's the mistake I've made. A journalist comes along and says, we're going to do an article on you. Oh great, there are people interested in my business, I'm going to get some visibility, I'll be able to sign customers and so on. Most of the time, you don't sign anything, it's time consuming and only flatters your ego since there's no economic spin-off from it. So the media, depending on the business, is really a waste of time that just flatters the ego and defocuses the real thing. And today, I systematically refuse all the general media, even though it's a great thing. Oh yeah, I'm going to be on TV, great, but in the end, nobody gives a damn. That's the hardest thing to do when you're launching a business. I'm talking about a startup whose vocation is to be a company with high growth potential, to grow in terms of staff and sales. On your own, that's nearly impossible. So you have to find partners. Finding partners is going to be quite difficult, since you'll be spending more time with them than with your partner. You're going to be working in the first few months 10 hours a day, and you're going to be spending your time with this person, so you need to be with people who are aligned with you and whom you admire. You need to admire the people you work with so that every morning you wake up and say to yourself, okay, they're machines, I want to do at least as well as them in what I do so that we're all aligned because I admire them for what they do, so I want them to admire me for what I do. So the notion of admiration is fundamental and often will associate by opportunity. I've met this person, I've got a good feeling about him. And it's this association part that is the main reason why startups fail. So absolutely avoid associating just for the sake of it. That's what we did, and it didn't go very well, and the legal issues afterwards are very complex. So it's absolutely essential to avoid joining forces for the sake of it. In recruitment, the first mistake startups make is to think unpaid interns are great, I'll recruit 5 or 10 and I'll get them to do lots of things. This doesn't work because unpaid interns need to be managed, they're waiting for you to train them, and it's often going to take you longer to manage them than the value they're going to deliver. So avoid unpaid interns at all costs. Just because they're unpaid doesn't mean it's interesting for a company. It's more of a defocus that's going to waste your energy at the start. Being an entrepreneur in the sense of being involved in execution, launching your company, taking the first steps, is a job that has nothing to do with the entrepreneur's job of managing a company, managing people. These are two completely distinct skills. And like any skill, it has to be learned. And to learn this managerial part, you need to be accompanied by an outsider. So for me, one of the main mistakes is not, as soon as the company can afford it, to coach the entrepreneurs and managers of the company to learn how to manage this human part. Because once again, the success of the company beyond the five first people is entirely linked to the people who make it up and how these people work together. So making sure that everyone is aligned, that each person in their role as manager is able to lead the others towards something better, is really an essential point that will enable the company behind it to grow. And it can grow healthily from 10 to 20, 30 or 50 people. Some people will want to set up a legal structure right away. You can test the market and make your first euros in sales a freestyle way. Make an entrepreneur status, make invoices on a free invoicing tool, and off you go. You need to make your first euros in sales, and the legal issues are a matter for lawyers and accountants. And it's for companies that need to survive. Here, the first problem is just making a living. Recruiting by opportunity. Oh, there's a good feeling. Maybe this person could do the job in the company. Networking is useless. Use more negative than positive feedback in management. Make a free product because you're afraid to sell. This is often the case. Look for an innovative business model because you don't want to sell, so you look for roundabout ways to make money. It never works. Fear of raising prices. Number one mistake of the French entrepreneur. You can always double your prices and you'll see it's a good way to double your income. Not being English first. This is an international world. Think of your business in English right away. Don't talk about your idea. We've got plenty of people who start their business and don't want to talk about my idea. The more you talk about it, the better. Trying to make partnerships, absolutely, when you don't have a product, and I think that's it.